So now let's move on to plastic deformation. As you are loading your specimen beyond elastic limit, then the material gets into plastic regime. That means what? You are actuating the dislocation motion and the material plasticity. So for many metals, the elastic deformation is only up to a strain of 0.005. Beyond that strain, for many metals, it will be usually plastic. But it's only a thumb rule. Don't tell me tomorrow I have started having this plastic deformation at 0.006. It is okay. It's only a ballpark number. Okay. And when you are when you deform your material beyond this elastic limit, that is when the plastic deformation starts. And the moment plastic deformation starts, your Hooke's law is not applicable anymore. That means sigma equal to E times epsilon cannot be used. Okay. And the plastic deformation is a result of the breaking of bonds with original atom neighbors and reforming of the bonds with the new neighbors. That is what we have discussed in the case of dislocation motion, right? So bond, original bond is broken and a new bond is formed with the neighbor. And as soon as you remove the stress, that means then you unload the material, the broken bonds, the atoms will not go back to their original neighbors, right? They will stay with the new neighbors. That means you are not able to go back to your original configuration. For crystalline materials, this plastic deformation happens by slip, which we have discussed extensively. And amorphous materials is a mechanism called viscous. You will also have plastic deformation in amorphous materials, but there, because there is no structure to amorphous materials, you cannot explain the deformation through slip. So you have to resort to other mechanisms which can be used to explain the plastic deformation. Okay. So this is previously we have seen our graph only up to here, and now we are going a little bit beyond. So this is the plastic deformation. So it is also called yielding. Yielding refers to the onset of plastic deformation. The moment, the point at which your plastic deformation starts, that is what you call onset of yielding or onset of plastic deformation, and that point is called yield point. Okay. And you also have something called proportionality limit. What is proportionality limit? Your stress is proportional to strain. That is, within that limit, your stress is proportional to strain. And just above proportionality limit and below yield point, you will still have elastic deformation. But stress and strain need not be proportional. But it is the gap between the proportionality limit and the elastic limit is very slow, very less. And hence, usually it is very difficult to identify. But you should know what is proportionality. So, yield strength is basically the point at which your plastic deformation starts. But when you are doing an experiment, it is extremely difficult to identify the point at which plastic deformation is beginning, right? For some materials, it may be easy to identify. For some materials, it is not at all possible to identify, because you will not get any indication that it is actually starting to plasticity. So, what do you need to do? But everybody in this world has to report same value of yield strength for a given material, right? I cannot have different yield strength for my material, my mild steel, and when you do it on your machine, you should not have a different yield strength, right? All of us should be reporting the same value. But it depends on who is in the experiment. If I am drawing a curve like that, let us say it's a linear elastic material. So I will, and then I will say this as my yield point. Okay, but somebody else says no. To me, this is looking like yield point. So it depends on, it becomes person specific. So we should not have person specific information being used as a standard, right? Rather, we should develop a standard. So the way that people have developed the standard is that the yield strength is defined as stress corresponding to 0.2% offset strain. What is the meaning of that? You look at 0.2% strain, that is 0.002 here. At that point, you draw a line parallel to your initial elastic line. That is your elastic modulus, right? This slope is giving you elastic modulus, so the linear elastic regime. Parallel to that line, you draw a line. Wherever that line intersects your stress strain curve, and that is your yield strength. And this is the world standard. Whenever somebody reports yield strength, they report yield strength this way. So, I don't know how you have measured your yield strength in your applied mechanics laboratory, but this is how you should measure. You should report the yield strength of that material to be 0.2% offset. Okay? And for nonlinear elastic materials, so this works very well for linear elastic materials, right? Because linear elastic materials, you know what is the slope and you will draw. But what will you do for nonlinear elastic materials? This guy is, the slope is changing, right? Which slope you will take? So, because there is an ambiguity, and hence for nonlinear elastic materials, usually the stress required to produce some amount of strain, 0.5% strain. So, if you have, let us say this is 0.005, that is 0.5% strain, then you draw a straight line, and that is your for nonlinear elastic. Okay? That is how you define yield strength for a linear elastic material and nonlinear elastic. So, this is the standard that one needs to use. You cannot use any other way, any as long as you are doing this method. Okay? Alright. So, this is something that you probably have seen in while testing the mild steel. So, typically this is what you will observe as the yield behavior for mild steel. So, you will have something called upper yield point, and then you will have a sudden drop in stress, and then you will have this lower yield point about which almost at constant stress you will have these oscillations, and then further hardening happens. Okay? So, this is not observable in all the materials. It is typical behavior that you will observe for mild steel. Okay? So, then upper yield point is where your actual yielding starts. But when you are reporting yield strength, you report yield strength as your lower yield. So, plastic deformation actually starts at upper yield point, and immediately there is a drop in engineering stress, and then this guy oscillates about a constant stress called lower yield point or lower yield strength, and that is what you report as yield strength of the material. Okay? So, why does this upper yield point dropping happens and then these oscillations? So, you know that steel is an alloy of iron and carbon, right? That's a mild steel is usually a plain carbon steel. So, there are no other solute atoms. Your solute atoms are carbon. So, compared to the size of the iron, carbon atom is smaller or larger? Small, right? So, what happens is when the dislocations are moving, the plastic deformation means what? Onset of dislocation motion, right? So, these dislocations, because your carbon is dispersed everywhere, it's an alloy, so everywhere you will see carbon. So, you have these solute atoms interacting everywhere with these dislocations. So, when the dislocation is moving, it gets pinned near the obstacle. The obstacle is your solute atom. That means the carbon atom is actually restricting the motion of the dislocation. But then, you are continuing to apply the load. The fact that the solute atom sizes are relatively small compared to your post atom, that is solvent iron atom, what happens is this dislocation can actually break open the obstacle. So, the pinning can be broken and then try to move. But again, there may be other dislocations which are getting pinned by other solute atoms and so on. And so, you will have so many interactions of these dislocations with the solute atoms, and the dislocations are getting pinned, and that is why you have these oscillations. Once the pinning happens, and then you are applying higher stress, and then the pin is broken, and then suddenly you will have a drop in stress. Again, some other obstacle comes, and you have these. That is why you have these oscillations. Okay? And then, after that, you will have, because it's a polycrystalline materials, right? Mild steel, the experiment that we are doing on a polycrystalline material, and suddenly what happens? Other strengthening mechanisms come into play. What is the other strengthening mechanism that we can think of? Where else the dislocations can get struck? near the grain boundary, right? Because it's a polycrystalline material. And initially they are affected by these solute atoms, and after some time the dislocations are moving because they are able to overcome the resistance offered by the solute atoms, and then suddenly the dislocation starts seeing the grain boundary, and there you need to apply much larger force in order to continue flashing deformation. That is why you see that it is getting harder and harder in to continue your plastic deformation. That is why it is called hardening ridging. This part is what we call hardening ridging. Okay? Any questions here? So this is a typical complete stress strain curve, which is called engineering stress strain curve. Whereas, so here you have material in the elastic regime, and here you have plastic regime, and then this is what you call ultimate strength of the material. That is what you call tensile strength. Whenever this is another material property, right? We have measured yield strength, elastic modulus, Poisson's ratio. Next important property is the yield strength of the material, tensile strength of the material. What does this represent? The tensile strength of the material is the strength, so the maximum stress that the material can resist before actually getting into necking. So necking means the localized deformation. And then finally, after necking, the stress strain curve drops, and eventually you will have failure. So this is tensile strength, and this is failure. Or fracture. Right? So now if you take a ductile material and a brittle material, typically the stress strain curves look something like this. So in the case of ductile material, you will have nice elastic deformation and an extended plastic deformation. Lot of energy is dissipated through the plastic deformation, and eventually it breaks. Whereas in the case of brittle materials, your yield strength is going to be higher. That means it can actually resist higher stresses, but it cannot store more energy. So the amount of energy that this guy can store is this much, whereas the brittle material can only store this. That means it will break without giving any signs. There is no plastic deformation, right? Then you will not be able to see that it's actually going to break, and that is suddenly the breaking happens. So for a brittle material, you cannot define something called yield strength. There is no yield strength for a brittle material. You will only have ultimate strength. That's where the failure happens directly. Whereas for ductile material, you will have a well-defined yield strength, right? Through 0.2% offset strain, and you can also measure your ultimate tensile strength. They are actually going to be different. Okay. So what is the yield strength of steel, for instance, the plain carbon steel, the mild steel? Are you familiar with this number? You know what is the elastic modulus of steel? That we know, right? Elastic modulus of steel is approximately 200 GPa. Sigma y, yield strength of steel, is approximately mild steel, I would say, because different alloying elements will increase this yield. 200 MPa. That's what you get. These numbers are same. Just this is GPa and this is MPa. Okay. Please note that this is stiffness and this is strength. They are different things. Right. All right. So, how do you go about measuring another property called ductility? How do you define ductility? Ductility is the ability of the material to be deformed well. Okay? So the ductility of a material is defined by something called percentage elongation or percentage reduction in area. So the percentage elongation at the time of failure. So that means length at the time of failure minus initial length by original length, and that gives you a measure for ductility. And you can clearly see in this case the LF is this corresponding to this point, L0 is corresponding to this point. This is strain, of course. And here, for ductile material, so you can clearly see that the percentage elongation, that means the strain for a brittle material at the time of failure, is much smaller than the strain that you can impart in a ductile material. Right? So that is the property called ductile. Okay, so are you familiar with this property called resilience? What is resilience? The ability to store energy. So the ability of the material to store energy up to elastic limit and then give it back. Right? That is an important property when you are designing springs. The next semester you will be dealing with design of friction elements, right? There you are, one of the modules for you to design is mechanical springs. There the property called resilience becomes very important. So there is the amount of energy that you can store in this component up to elastic limit, because you don't want to impart plastic deformation when you are designing, right? So the ability of the material to absorb energy when deformed elastically and to return it when unloaded ready, and that property is called resilience. And how do you measure this? This is basically the area under the stress strain curve up to elastic limit or yield strength, just before yielding. So up to here it is only elastic deformation, right? Only beyond that it is plastic, and hence you can say that this is my measure of resilience. Okay, so you can calculate modulus of resilience to be 1/2 sigma y epsilon when it is a linear elastic. All right, how do you measure, how do you define toughness? How do you define toughness? So, ability of the material to store energy until fracture, until permanent failure, right? So, the total energy under the stress strain curve. All right, area under the total stress strain curve. Now, we need to define something called, so we have looked at the stress strain curve so far, and the stress strain curve that we have looked at until now is what is called engineering stress strain. And now you also need to define something called true stress strain curve. Why it is called true? Because the stress, when you are defining the one dimensional stress, we are saying load per unit area, right? But that area in the case of engineering stress is the original cross section. But we know that as we are deforming the material in this direction, the dimensions in the lateral direction are changing. That means your cross sectional area is actually evolving. And hence, if you define a stress term with respect to the current cross sectional area, then that is what is called true stress. Right? Similarly, when you are defining strain with respect to the current length, then it is called true stress. Okay? So the definition of true stress is force, uniaxial force applied per unit area. That unit area is instantaneous area. I is instantaneous. And suppose if you want to define true strain, so the incremental strain can be written as current change in length over the total current length. And then if you integrate integral d epsilon from 0 to say, let us say, current strain, then when the strain is 0, this is L naught, currently Li, and if you do that, then you will get epsilon t is equal to natural log instant current length divided by volume. And that is what is the definition of your true strain. Right, this you must have studied or done in your strength of materials class. And of course, well, when you are deforming, we know that before necking, your volume does not change. So AI LI, that means the current volume must be equal to your initial volume. Right? So by using these relations, you can always write a relation between true components of the stress and the engineering component. So true stress is equal to sigma times 1 plus epsilon. How can we do that? you see sigma t equal to f by ai, and that equal to f by a naught times a naught by ai, right? And then you can write f by a naught is sigma, that is engineering component. A by a naught can, a naught by ai can be written as, what is a naught by ai? Li by l naught, right? From using this, from li by l naught, from Li by L0 you can actually write that as 1 plus epsilon, because engineering strain is Li minus L0 by L0, change in length by original length. So similarly you can also write a relation between true strain and the engineering strain. Okay, so you should always be able to write the relations between engineering components and true components. Then we will see what happens in the hardening regime in tomorrow's class. Okay.